This is the video lecture on accounts receivable. Before we talk about accounts receivable, we're going to talk a little bit about cash sales. Now, the nice thing about a cash sale is that it does provide an immediate inflow of cash for the business. And the other great thing about it is that there's absolutely no risk involved, because in a situation like this, we receive the cash money immediately. So if you look at this example, we're assuming a $1,000 cash sale of merchandise, and the journal entry would be recorded in this manner. We would debit cash, $1,000, and credit sales, $1,000. And the idea is this is an asset, and we show the increase in cash, and we show the revenue in the form of sales. And a transaction like this will require no further adjustment because we already have collected the money immediately upon selling the merchandise. So that's a cash sale that has absolutely no risk. But then if you move forward to a credit sale, in this type of situation, there is a risk. Now, the one nice thing about credit sales is that the theory behind it is that it does give the customer a motivation to buy more. The idea is that hopefully they would buy more than they would have normally because we're allowing them to charge and allowing them to pay us at a later date. But the downside is that it does expose our business to risk, and that would be the risk of non-payment. So sticking with the same basic example, it's still a $1,000 sale, but this time it's a credit sale. So really the only difference that you see here is in the debit account title. Rather than cash, I would use accounts receivable because that's going to be the asset that I need to use. They owe me that money. Eventually, I should be able to collect that money. Although it's always possible that we won't be paid, so that's always a risk that we face anytime we have a credit sale and anytime we have an account receivable. Now, another option for our business would be to have credit card sales. And a lot of businesses allow customers to charge using credit cards. Now, the nice thing about this is it still gives the customer the option to charge, but it does not expose the company to any risk. And the reason is that the risk is being borne by the credit card company. If the customer fails to pay for that sale, that's between them and their credit card company. The business doesn't have to worry about it because we definitely will have our money. Now, in order to accept certain credit cards, we're going to have to make a decision as a business which cards that we are willing to accept. And you've probably noticed many times when you're shopping, you will often see a sign and it lists the actual credit cards that that particular store is willing to accept. And the reason is different credit cards charge different fees. It's not going to be free. You know, we are going to have to lose a little bit of money in order to accept this credit card. But the idea is maybe it's worth it to lose a little bit of money if we don't have to bear any of the risk. So the fee that they charge, it could be 1%, 2%, 5%. It really just depends on the credit card company. So that's one difference. And then another difference, some of the credit card companies will immediately deposit the money, whereas other credit card companies, they actually have us send them the receipts and they will periodically send us the money. So there's a little bit of a delay there. So really those are the two key differences, the percentage that's being charged and the method of payment. And based on that, as a business, we will make a decision about what credit cards we will accept and the ones that we don't accept. If you look at this example, we have a customer and they want to purchase $1,000 worth of merchandise and they're going to utilize their credit card. And the particular credit card that is involved here happens to charge a 2% fee. And it also happens to be the type of card that remits payment to the business. which means that instead of getting the money immediately, there's a little bit of a delay. So in order to record this, assuming that this is a credit card that we accept, this will actually require a couple of journal entries. Now the first entry, you see that we're debiting accounts receivable. Now why is it accounts receivable? Because this is one of those credit cards that does not send us the cash money immediately. There's going to be a delay. So that means that for a short time, that's actually going to be a receivable, and we're going to eventually receive that money. So that's why we're debiting accounts receivable. Now down here on the credit side, we're crediting sales for the full $1,000, which is the retail price. But notice up here, I'm not using $1,000, only $980. And that is because of that 2% fee. Now you start to see the true cost of accepting these credit cards. I'm not really bearing any risk, but I am giving up some of the money. So since this credit card charges me a 2% fee, I'm actually only going to get 98% of the money. So $1,000 times 0.98 is $980. I will only receive $980. And then I have a discrepancy. I have $980 as a debit, $1,000 as a credit. I'm $20 out of balance. So that $20 is going to be over here as a debit, and it's going to go to credit card expense. And basically, we just lost $20 by accepting that credit card. But maybe it's worth it, because maybe it's worth losing $20 to not have to bear any risk. And maybe because we accepted that credit card, maybe it encouraged the customer to buy that much from us. And then you have the subsequent journal entry. As time has passed, eventually the credit card company remits the money back to us. And when that happens, we debit cash $980 and remove the account receivable, because now we have received the payment. So that's how that works in a credit card situation. Now, moving on from credit cards, if we are going to allow our customers to charge and charge directly to our business, as I said before, that exposes our business to risk. And one of the big risks that we face are bad debts. When we book a receivable, we record that in good faith, and we assume in a very optimistic way that the customer is going to pay. But sometimes they don't always pay. And when that happens, we have a bad debt. And in order to account for the bad debts, we actually have two different things that we're going to learn about, because these are the GAAP approved methods of dealing with bad debts. And they're going to be called direct write-off and allowance. So the first thing is direct write-off. This is a GAAP-approved method for dealing with bad debts. And the way this one works is, if we know for a fact that a particular bad debt is not going to be collected, then we need to go ahead and do the conservative thing and actually write off that debt as a loss. And the reason that we would know this is, as time passes, you know, eventually we're going to realize that we're never going to get the money. In fact, the longer it goes, the less and less likely it is that the customer will ever pay. So if you look at this example, we have a $500 account receivable, and it's due from a particular customer named John Smith, and we've decided that this is uncollectible. How do we know it's uncollectible? Probably because it has been so long that we really doubt at this point that this customer will ever pay. So we're going to go ahead and do a direct write-off and just eliminate that receivable. And it's going to cause us to lose $500, but it's the right thing to do, because in all honesty, if we really don't think we're going to get the money, then it's really not appropriate to leave that on the books. So to write this off, I'm going to use a new expense account. And we've never used this one before. It's called Bad Debts Expense. I'll charge that account with $500 of expense, and I'll go ahead and remove the account receivable under John Smith for $500. So that eliminates the receivable and shows the expense, shows the loss of $500 on that bad debt. Now, the thing about direct write-off is that even though we think it's going to be a bad debt, it may not be. Sometimes, to our surprise, sometimes the customer involved actually does end up following up and paying us. So even though it's been a long time, even though we doubted that we would ever get the money, maybe they had a change of heart, maybe they got their financial house in order, but for whatever reason, they have actually decided to finally pay us. Well, if that's the case, we will recover that bad debt. And that actually requires two journal entries. The first journal entry is an exact reversal of the previous entry. And by reversing that, it will reinstate that debt. And once that debt is reinstated, then we can show the collection of the money. We received the $500. We again removed that account receivable. So that's the proper way to record that. And this is a good example of conservatism, because back when I removed that bad debt, I really did not actually know whether or not John Smith was going to pay, but I decided to go ahead and be conservative and write it off. Well, luckily, it turned out as a good ending. He did actually pay, and when we make this type of adjustment, this is a positive adjustment. So sometimes when you are a little bit pessimistic and conservative, and you then later have to make an adjustment, it's okay because this is a good thing. We are actually showing additional money that we didn't think we were actually going to receive. Now, in addition to the direct write-off, that's actually not enough to account for our bad debts. As good as the direct write-off method is, the problem with it is you don't really know that a debt is going to be a bad debt until so much time has passed that it's obvious that it's a bad debt. So really that's an okay strategy, and we would do that, but we also need to do something else in addition to that. And this is going to be called the allowance method. And this is a gap requirement. And according to this method, we're going to go ahead and be conservative, somewhat pessimistic, and we're going to go ahead and estimate the amount of bad debts. Because based on our past experience, we know, being realistic about it, that we're not going to always collect 100% of all the debts that are out there. So we can base that on our past experience and come up with a percentage. We could calculate that percentage either as a percentage of sales, the credit sales, or even the receivables themselves. And that way we're going to go ahead and acknowledge the fact that at least some of the debts are not going to be collected. So to see this as an example, we have a business here that in total had $100,000 in credit sales. So all that money is basically an account receivable. Now, based on their past experience, and based on what's happened in previous years with customers, they feel that about 1% of the time, those debts are going to be uncollectible. So that's going to be their estimate under allowance method. So 1% of 100,000 is 1,000. So we'll just go ahead preemptively and record a bad debt adjustment for $1,000. And the way we do that is to debit bad debt expense, $1,000, and then credit allowance for doubtful accounts. And that is the account that we use for that allowance method to show that we are estimating that these number of debts are going to be bad debts.